Hey there, friend. In this video lecture, we are talking about the pathophysiology and the nursing interventions for diabetic ketoacidosis. I'm going to break down the pathophysiology into super, super simple steps for you to follow. These steps are super helpful for nursing students, so stick around because you will finally understand it after this video. And write love in the comments below if you want more full video lectures just like this one to help you out with nursing school. I want to know what you think. So let's do it. So DKA, in a nutshell, happens when there is not enough insulin in the body. Insulin is required to help glucose move into the cells. Glucose is the cell's best source of energy. So without insulin, the cells cannot get any glucose. So because the cells don't have insulin, the cells start converting fat into energy instead. And this fat breakdown then leads to ketones building up in the blood, which are acids. So that's just a brief overview of what's going on here in DKA. Now, DKA happens mostly in patients with type 1 diabetes, but it can also happen with type 2, although that's pretty rare. So let's think about this. DKA happens when there's not enough insulin in the body. And during type 1 diabetes, the pancreas is not making any insulin. So that's why it mostly happens with type 1 diabetes. During type 2 diabetes, the cells become resistant to insulin. So in type 2 diabetes, it's really not a problem of a lack of insulin in the body, but rather a lack of insulin's ability to move glucose into the cells because the cells are resistant to that insulin. This is pretty rare though. DKA mostly happens with type 1 diabetes, but in either case, insulin cannot get glucose into the cells. So let's walk through what happens with this step by step. Now, you will not see these steps anywhere else. They're not official or anything. I just made them up to make learning all of this way easier for you, so you won't find them in your textbook or anything. Step one of the pathophysiology of diabetic ketoacidosis is there is not enough insulin. So normally in your body, your pancreas produces insulin, and insulin's job is to grab onto glucose and then move it into the cells so that the cells can use them for energy. But in the case of diabetic ketoacidosis, there is not enough insulin. And this leads to hyperglycemia, which is step two of the pathophysiology of DKA. This causes hyperglycemia because there isn't any insulin around to then move glucose into those cells. So all of that glucose just builds up and builds up and builds up in the blood. It can't get into the cells, it's stuck outside. So the cells are there really wanting their glucose because they need that energy. But thankfully, they have some stored up fat to use for energy instead. And this is what happens during DKA. The cells use fat for energy. Here's the key point you need to know about diabetic ketoacidosis. When fat is converted to energy, ketones are produced, and ketones are acids. Now this is step number four. Ketones are produced as a byproduct of fat metabolism. This is a key point to remember for DKA. The cells use fat for energy instead of glucose. And when fat is broken down into ketones, ketones are released and ketones are acids. And because there's all of this acid release, it leads us to step number five of DKA, which is acidosis. The more ketones levels rise in the body, the more the acid level rises in the body because the ketones are acids. And so the more ketones there are, the more serious the acidosis becomes. And this is considered metabolic acidosis. Now, if you want to deep dive into metabolic acidosis, do not worry, we've got you covered. I've got a whole other video on metabolic acidosis that you can check out. I'll put the link down below this video in the description for you to watch it if you'd like. In that video, I walk you through what metabolic acidosis is, what causes it, and so you will definitely want to check it out. So now that we know the pathophysiology of diabetic ketoacidosis, let's talk about some of the nursing interventions for DKA that you might do as a nurse. So what sort of things that you would do as a nurse to help fix the problem? Now, there are several nursing interventions you might do for a patient with DKA. These might be things like giving fluids, giving insulin, and continuing to assess them. If you are in the Nursing SOS membership community, you know me, you know that I am always talking about how important the nursing assessment is. And actually, that reminds me, I have a free nursing assessment cheat sheet for you, but it's even better than a cheat sheet. It's a full head-to-toe show assessment transcript. So it literally walks you through the nursing assessment word for word, so you can use it as a guide when you practice assessing a patient. It's amazing. You are going to love it. So I will put a link down below this video in the description for you to check that out if you think that would be helpful for you. So let's talk about fluid treatment for DKA. Giving fluids is one of the two main treatments you'll do with a patient with DKA. Now the goal here is to reduce the blood glucose level and keep the patient's organs perfused. Of course, fluid treatment will depend on what the doctor has ordered and your particular patient's situation, but typically you'll give normal saline, lactated ringers, half normal saline, or 5 to 10% dextrose in half normal saline. There are different reasons for giving these different fluids, so let's walk through them here. Normal saline or lactated ringers is usually given first because these solutions are isotonic, meaning that they're not going to force fluid any which way. These solutions are going to stay inside the blood vessels, which is where we want them in this case. Now, half normal saline might be used after normal saline or lactated ringers in order to hydrate the cells, because half normal saline will push some fluid into the cells to help rehydrate them. You might also give 5 to 10% dextrose and half normal saline as the blood glucose level in the body drops to about 250 to 300 milligrams per deciliter. Now this can be kind of confusing. Why would we want to give glucose when we're trying to drop the patient's blood glucose level? Well, this is super important to do because you don't want to drop it too much too fast. We are basically controlling the blood glucose level by giving some more glucose and then controlling the rate that the blood glucose level decreases. Let's think about it. If we just give normal fluids without glucose plus insulin, that insulin could drop the blood glucose way, way too fast. So when the blood glucose level drops and reaches between 250 to 300 milligrams per deciliter, you might want to give glucose along with those fluids depending on the doctor's orders. So that is the rationale for each of those IV fluids. Now, if you want a deeper dive into those IV fluids, we have a whole video for you to check out on that tonicity. It's super, super good. It will give you a quick and easy breakdown of isotonic, hypertonic, and hypotonic solutions. I'll put that link down below this video in the description as well. Now let's talk about insulin treatment. So we know that the core problem and the pathophysiology of DKA is a lack of insulin, right? So obviously we'll need to give insulin to help the cells take up that glucose for energy so that they can stop using fat for energy and stop producing those acidic ketones. Depending on the doctor's orders, you might give regular insulin through an IV to help move that glucose into the body cells. If you do this, you will need to constantly assess their blood glucose level during treatment. Seriously, because you do not want to drop their blood sugar too fast. And here's why. The body is always wanting to stay in balance. So if you drop the blood glucose level way too fast, the water in the body will try to rebalance itself and it will move from the intracellular fluid called the ICF to the extracellular fluid called the ECF. And if this happens too fast, fluid will move into the cerebrospinal fluid to try to maintain that balance. And this can lead to swelling in the brain and can cause increased intracranial pressure. Now this is super dangerous and causes even more of a medical emergency. So it is super duper important, my friend, that you are always, always assessing your patient and being very careful when giving insulin and fluid treatment. And of course, like I said, I am a stickler for the nursing assessment, if you can't already tell. So let's walk through some things that you will need to assess for. You'll need to assess their intake and their output, their weight, and continually monitor for their respirations, their respiratory status. You'll assess their IV, assess their fluids and their fluid status, make sure all the correct fluids are running and infusing like they should be. Check their blood glucose level, check their ABG values and their potassium and their sodium levels. Now, diabetic ketoacidosis can seriously mess up the fluid and electrolyte balance in the body, so it's super important to keep an eye on that. You will also constantly assess their mental status to clue you in on any increased intracranial pressure. Like we said before, if the fluid shifts into that cerebrospinal fluid, it can cause swelling in the brain and increased intracranial pressure. So you need to always, always be assessing for that. Friend, you are a rock star nursing student. I know all of this is a lot to learn, but just because you're here with me right now, watching this video tells me that you're doing better than you think you are. You are obviously super dedicated to becoming the best nurse that you can be. So keep going, my friend. Do not give up. I know you can do it. Now, if this video helped you out, write love in the comments below to let me know that you want more full video lectures just like this one to help you out with nursing school. I want to know what you think. Seriously, friend, let me know in the comments. And of course, make sure to subscribe and click the little bell so you never miss a future video to help you raise your grades and have more free time in nursing school. That's what we're all about here. And in the next video, we're gonna walk through the DKA lab values you need to know about. So click on the next video and go become the nurse that God created only you to be. I'll see you in the next video.